We're going to cover a few things today. Now, I did say that this would be about an hour, so admission time. I've run through this earlier and there is no way I can do this in an hour. There's a lot of material. Hi, Clifford. So what we're going to do, I'm going to cover all the big points early on to make it last just an hour. And we're going to take a 2 or 3 minute break in case you need a visit to the bathroom or you need a drink of water or something like that. And then I'll continue. For those of you who want to stay on, we'll get into some more of the techniques that we can use. I'll cover some of the slightly more advanced combinations that we're going to look at and give you some more ideas on how to make your videos just stand out. Whether you're using Camtasia or anything else doesn't really matter. Camtasia is the one we're looking at today. So we're going to get started in a second or two. I know that people are still signing in, so let me just allow another 10 or 15 seconds for that. And just to confirm for anybody who's not sure, because there is quite a lot to cover, we're actually going to be recording this, so assuming everything goes well, you will be able to see a replay by the weekend, and you'll also see the edited version of this webinar. So I'll explain what I mean by that in a moment or two. So let's actually get going properly. So thank you for joining me. Today's particular training session is about quick and easy Camtasia video editing tips. Now the format is going to be about 60 minutes if I can make it as short as that, but I'll probably split the webinar into two for those of you who can stick around, and most of it, probably about 99%, is going to be live demo rather than theory. So you're going to see me doing the things that I'm talking about. You'll be able to follow along if you want to, or you can review the video later, because there will be a recording. Unless there's an unforeseen accident or technical glitch, there will be a recording later this weekend. Of course, questions are always welcome. I like live questions. If there's something you need to see, please let me know. Hi Anita, hi Peter. Peter's asking about a video tutorial for a particular product. There's a basic one and there's a manual, Peter. But there's more to come. Hi Ted, thanks for joining me. So we're going to do mainly demonstration, and just as a quick overview, the questions are live, so you can ask me, and there is a webinar chat down in the bottom right hand corner of the screen that you're on. You'll see a little red tab. If you click on that, you can submit a question and I'll try to answer as many as I can. I will keep breaking off to check your questions, so if you need me to show something again, please let me know. Now, one of the things that we're going to do in this video is, I'm recording it of course, and the version that you will see when it's online will be an edited version. So some of the things that I'm going to tell you about and show you how to do, I'm actually going to put in the final video, so you'll see the real use of them. And there's a couple of tricks in particular that I think you'll enjoy. So we're going to jump straight into Camtasia Studio. Some of you will already know that you can get a free trial. If you can't afford Camtasia right now, you can get a free trial, make a whole batch of videos, put these editing techniques into use, start using those videos to generate site visitors or revenue or whatever you're using them for, adverts, that kind of a thing. And that's before you ever need to spend a single cent. So you can actually get going for nothing. So let me just check if we've got any questions. Hi Chris, thanks for joining us. So we're going to get straight into Camtasia. Now my screen size is a bit smaller than I would normally work on, so what I'll have to do sometimes is move things around to show you where they are and kind of emphasize the certain things. So what I've got over here is a directory full of documents, and we've got images and a movie and so on, and these are going to be my source files. So what I want you to imagine is that you're creating, let's say, an advert for one of your sites. You may have a weight loss site, you may have a camping site, you may have a membership site, whatever it may be. There's a way to make your videos stand out more and give you a little bit of authority as well. So I'm going to use these particular images that we've got here, as you can see, and I'm going to show you how to use these in lots of different ways. And there's quite a few different ones here. This one, by the way, is just an example e-cover. As far as I know, there is no real diet where you're allowed to have lots of sugar and sweets. If there is, I want to know it. I'll buy the book. But just for fun, I'm using that as an e-cover to show you how you can emphasize your product within the video. Or, and here's the one of the tips, you can emphasize somebody else's product. If you don't have a product of your own, if you're marketing as an affiliate, you can do the same thing in video that I'm about to show you, but you would do it with the marketing materials from the merchant themselves. And I'll show you an example of that as we go. So if you're not familiar with Camtasia, when you first open, this is the project window, and we can import media here, which goes into the clip bin, and then once the various files are imported, we can start working with them. So I'm just going to go look for, I've got a movie. Okay, this one here is a movie. It's a short review I created of a particular product. Now, the product actually has no bearing on the examples I'm going to give you. It's just a piece of video to show you. I have it sort of lying around so I can show you, how it works and so on. I'm being asked by Donald if this will work with version 7. Some of the things I'm showing you will work with version 7, absolutely. Yeah, not everything, because some of the techniques in here do require version 8, but you'll see as we go, and some of them you can kind of adapt for yourself. So there we have a video, and that's just me reviewing a little gadget, because I like gadgets. And what you can see, this is a plain video. There's nothing on the screen, no particular text or anything like that. So, my aim in that video was to review the product and give people information, but also to drive them to my website where the affiliate links are and hopefully get some commissions. So first thing I'm going to do is use this slider so that I can see more of my working space. If I zoom over to the left, I can see the entire video. And if I zoom over to the right, I can zoom right into individual frames and work very precisely. For this first section, I want to zoom all the way out so I can see the entire thing. So it's about an eight minute video. Now I want to brand this with my main website. So I'm going to show you how to do that right now. And this is one of the first tricks. So when you're doing a video, particularly on YouTube, other people may embed it on their blogs. They may use it. You'll have heard people teaching you how to do this, I'm sure, how to use other people's videos to promote your own sites and so on. If you brand a video, then anybody who embeds your video from YouTube onto their blog or wherever is actually doing you a favor because they're getting you more exposure. So branding is a particularly important thing to do because it protects you from having your video kind of stolen. And it does mean that if somebody uses it, you get the credit for having made the video and telling people where to go to find out more. I'm being told that the audio has clicking to it. Joseph, I don't know. Does anybody else have clicking? While I'm waiting for answers on that, Ted, I can import files one by one, or if I prefer, I can do a whole batch of them at once like this. But personally, I think if I did that right now, it would confuse the demonstration. If I were doing this myself, I would import all the files I want at one time and then work on them. But I want to show you how this builds up so that you can see how it works. So let me just make sure people can hear me. Oh, wow. Clicking while I talk. That's really problematic. Okay. Well, it's being recorded, so if there's a problem, then let me know. I'm not quite sure why there's a clicking, but it does happen sometimes. I'm going to turn the sound down a little in case it's too high, so let me do that. So what's the sound volume like now? If you can just check that for me. Is it any better or any worse? Is that... Ah, Peter's saying that seems a bit better. I had it too high. Okay, so maybe it was just turned up too high. Now, I'm going to put a branding called a lower third down here so that I can put my website name and have it permanently displayed on the video. So I'm going to use a callout for this. And in the callout we have a whole range of different effects. But I start by clicking on Add Callout, and then I can choose the one I want. So I can add the callout and then select the type I'm looking for. I don't have to select the type first. You can select it if you want, but I like to do it this way. I'm going to use a simple rectangle. And then if I scroll down, I'm going to change some of these settings because I don't want it this color. First of all, I'm getting rid of the border so it doesn't stand out against the background. I'm going to change the fill to... I quite like this color personally. You know, that's a personal preference. You choose what color you like. And I don't want shadow on this. That's number one. Now I want my text to be black, so I'm just choosing the text color box here, choosing black. It was on white, as you can see. And I probably want maybe 24 size text, but if I want to change it later, I can do that. So let me just type in my good stuff reviewed. Ooh, can't spell. .com. Now you can see that doesn't look particularly good, so what I'm going to do now is resize this and watch what happens. So it's starting to look a bit better, and I'm dragging it down to where a lower third normally appears. A lower third just normally appears here, and we're used to seeing this on documentaries, on TV shows, on news items. And because people are so conditioned to seeing this on TV, it lends an air of authority immediately, because it's what they do on TV. So if you copy the tactics that are used on TV, you will get some of the kind of impact that those techniques have. Now I think that's far too small, that font, so I'm just going to select the wording and then change the font maybe to 48, which is okay. Just need to resize that. So that's what it looks like now. I'm not sure that I like the font, so again I'm just going to change things a little bit. I've selected this and I'm going to use my personal favorite, which is this one. But you use the one that you like, okay? I mean, this is all personal choice at this stage. Okay, so what I have now is an image with some text that lasts for 5 seconds. After 5 seconds, it disappears. So I've lost my branding. So here's the next little tip. If you have an image like this, all you have to do, you can see I'm pointing at the bottom of the screen here, hover over the image, and then you get this double-headed arrow will appear. Click your mouse button, hold it down, and drag to as long as you want. Now in my case, I'm going to go as long as the entire video. And if you notice, at the end, it will snap into place. I don't know if you can quite see that, but it snaps to line up with the end of the video. So that's a nice handy little way of making sure it lasts for the entire video. And there we go. Now, there is something else to be aware of, which is that on these callouts, you can have a fade in and a fade out, and these are normally automatically set for you with whatever settings you had before. I'm going to turn them down to nothing and nothing, and you'll see why. Okay, so that means it will actually come in immediately. Right, so there we go. As soon as the video starts, I've got the My Good Stuff reviewed. So far, so simple. This is a static lower third. It will do the job. It will show the viewers the website. It can give them your name, that kind of a thing. But let me show you something else. If I want to make it a little bit more like a traditional lower third on, say, a news program, I can add an effect, and I click on More here, and then click on I click on Transitions. And what I'm looking for, if I scroll down, is this thing called a gradient wipe. This is quite nice. If you just click and drag it onto the beginning, let me just zoom out so I can get to the end very easily, and then click and drag to the end, and what I'm doing is just kind of dropping it there on the rectangle. This is track 2. By the way, you can change the names here to remind you what the tracks are, so let me just do that. So this track is going to be My Site Lower Third. So as I'm working, I can remember what I'm doing. It tells me what the track is. So let's actually play that, and hopefully there'll be enough bandwidth for you to see this. And this is how the video would start, and then the lower third is going to wipe in. It's quite a nice effect, very simple, takes literally seconds to do. So let's play that now. So there you go. So that actually came in, and it attracts attention. So at the very start of the video, I'm attracting the attention of the person watching and telling them about my site immediately. I don't even have to mention it or say it out loud. That lower third has done it for me. At the end of the video, it does the reverse because I dropped in that gradient wipe again. Just watch this. And so as we get to the end, the lower third will disappear. Now that's fine. For the entire length of the video, we've got a lower third, and it comes in nicely at the beginning, zooms out nicely at the end. if I want to vary the information throughout the entire video, for example, I may want to introduce myself, what I can do is just drag this. All I've done is hover over the end of the track. I get the double-headed arrow there, as you can see, and I can drag this to wherever I want. So let me just zoom in so I can be a bit more precise. Let's say after 10 seconds. So I'm at about 10 seconds there, yeah. Actually, it wants to be further down than 10 seconds. Yeah, so at 10 seconds, which was actually there, so not quite right. There we go, 10 seconds. At 10 seconds, it will fade out. So now I've got nothing on here, no lower third. So I've introduced my website, and then after 10 seconds, it will fade away. There's a very quick and easy way to reuse this to make as many lower thirds as I want to, and I'm going to show you that in about 2 seconds or so. So highlight your rectangle, the one that you've just formatted. You've got it the way you like, you've got the background color the way you like, you've got the position the way you like, everything's the way you like it, the fade in at the beginning, the fade out. So now if I right click, I can copy this, and if I position myself anywhere further away from it on the timeline here, just over to the right as you can see, and then right click, I can paste a copy, and what I will get is exactly the same lower third. If I double click this now, I can change the wording. So I put my name now, okay, and I might want to change it so it's left aligned. There we go. I'm just using the alignment buttons here. So now what I get is the lower third introducing the site disappears. I've got a second or two, and then I'm introducing myself. And now because this is a copy, I can also change the size, because that looks a little bit too long to me. So just by dragging this over here, I can make it a little bit slightly more fitting. So let me just show you that again. I'll play that now. Okay, so we now have two lower thirds for the price of one. If I later want to put a lower third that explains where the product is, or what it's called, or the price, or anything like that, I can do the same thing again by copying and pasting. I will do that in a second for you. So far, we're talking about branding your site and introducing yourself and so on. But you can use the lower third for anything. If you had a viewer's question, you could put that on there. And if anybody submits a question, I may do that live for you. So if you have a particular question, let me know. But what I want to do now is show you something about these little symbols here. Now, when I dropped these onto the track, this was that thing called gradient wipe, if you remember. And I can drag these to change the impact. So I can make the wipe take longer or go faster, and that will affect how the lower third appears. So let me show you on this particular one. If I just hover, get the double-headed arrow, and then drag this over, let's say to there, that will make it a much slower appearance. So just watch now and see how slow it is to wipe in. You'll see the difference in impact. You see? So you can get that as fast or as slow as you want. And generally speaking, slower would be slightly more effective than better, because it's catching the eye for longer. Movement on screen catches the eye. So if you make it a bit slower, it's better. Now at the end, you see how fast it disappears? Let me replay that for you. Okay. And I can make it a little bit quicker just by dragging that to the right. Let's just show that for you. So we can play around with the introductory delay and the closing delay to suit our purposes. If you're getting rid of something, doing it fairly quick is generally a good idea, because you're done with the information. When you're introducing information, the more there is to introduce, the longer you need it to be for people to have time to see it, and the longer you need it to stay on screen. Now, this particular block here, where it's my name, that will last from 11 seconds to 21. So it's a 10 second block. if I'm particularly egocentric and I want my name in there for 20, 30, 40 seconds, I can drag the entire track to the right. And if you look what I'm doing with the mouse, I'm hovering it over the blue part of the track here. So I'm getting a double-headed arrow for the length of this image, or rectangle, or call out, or lower third, right? And I just drag it, and I can make it last as long as I want. So it now lasts quite a long time. Okay. If I think it's lasting too long, I can do the reverse, just drag it back here and make it quite short, and so on. So we can tweak things to suit our purposes, and that means we can also have them lining up with musical beats, for example. So if you have background music, or you have a particular emphasis on a certain word, you can make this match the phrase. If I just zoom in a little, let me show you what I mean. So you can see here, if I just click here where the mouse is, that's where I begin to speak again, and you can see that it's fading out after I start speaking. I may want it to fade out just before I start speaking, or I may want it to begin fading as I start speaking, and then just by dragging this here and lining them up visually, you see, I can have an impact on when this actually appears and disappears and what it matches. So you can get synchronized lower thirds with your audio. So let me just zoom out again so we can see the entire track just a little bit further in, I think. There we go. So in this particular case, I've got the website and then my name. Now in reality, that's not particularly normal. You'd normally introduce yourself and then you'd put the website. So let me just click on here, drag this over, click on here, push my name to the beginning, and then click on here and push the website to match right up to the edge of the name, lower third. Let's have a look at how that looks now. So at this point I'd be saying something like, "Hello, I'm Eamon Motin. Thank you for joining me today on my YouTube channel. What I've got for you today is something that I've reviewed on my website, mygoodstuffreviewed.com." Okay? And so on. Now, at the moment, after a few seconds, this lower third disappears. So remember that little trick we had? If I hover over here and drag, I can make this last the entire length of the video. So I've now got branding the entire way through. So that's the first thing, a simple lower third. Now, the callouts that you get give you a variety of shapes and sizes. I mean, you have this kind of pointy circle and rounded rectangles, and you can combine these so that you get different shapes. So let me just show you what I mean. So if I now add a callout, it will duplicate the previous one, as you can see. But if I then choose, let's say, yeah, the wedge looks quite good, the wedge, it will change it for me. Now, if I drag this over here, and maybe put that, let me just zoom up so you can see what I'm doing. And let's just resize that so I've got some space to work with. What I've got is a slightly different type of lower third with an interesting shape. So I can build things up and make them into combos, combinations. But it's obscuring the actual text. Now that's easily fixed. What I do, take my simple rectangle, and I'm going to drag it up onto a new track. So let me add a new track here. So click on Insert Track, and then drag this straight up to that track. And now you can see the blue has gone behind My Good Stuff Reviewed. Now if I want this to be the entire length of the lower third, remember I can just drag this right or left, doesn't matter which, and I can make it match the entire length of that lower third. So wherever we are on that lower third, I've got this wedge shape. Okay, and if I want to, I can, you know, I can change the size of the wedge and do all this kind of stuff, you know, hide part of it if I wanted to. So I could make sort of a shape like that. So by playing around with what you might call the native elements, I can get something that starts to look a little bit more interesting in terms of a lower third. Now it does have some lower thirds built in. In the library you've got various themes and so on. Let me just have a look at a couple of themes here. I honestly do not like the lower thirds that are provided with Camtasia. They look a bit cheesy, they look a bit, you know, and they don't reflect my personality, they don't reflect my personal taste. When I'm doing a video, people would, you know, tend to know that it's my kind of style of video. There's a certain degree of consistency within a particular niche, and so I'd like to use the particular designs that I favour so that I can have a personality showing in the video. And that's an important part of branding yourself, because of course you want to, you know, kind of stand out from the crowd. So there's an example. We've got this, let's just go back and zoom back in so you can see it properly. So you can see what it looks like. Hello, I'm Eamon Motin. Thank you for joining me. Today I'm going to show you something called a mouse pen, and that's on mygoodstuffreview.com if you want to take a full look. Okay, so you see we can do a kind of a voiceover at the same time. And I've got a nice little rectangle for the lower third, and I've got this nice wedge shape. Now, there's a little trick we've got here. Once I'm happy with these two, I don't really want to be messing around with them again, and I don't want them to get out of sync, I don't want them to lose each other, I want them to stay where they are. So if I highlight this one and highlight that one, they both turn blue, and if I right click, I can group it, which is kind of cool, because what it does is it locks them together. So now I've got a single clip that does the job, okay? And that means if I decide to move this earlier on the timeline or have it appear later, I just move one single group and it will move both of those individual elements for me. Now I've got two elements in here, but you could build up three, four, five, as many as you want to make a very unique style and shape for your lower third. That's really down to your personal taste, you know, and the kind of style you like, but you can build up something that's very unique to you, so that it stands out. You're branding yourself not just with the lower third text, but also the look and feel and style. Now, if you decide that you want to change that, maybe we didn't want blue there, let me just click on this plus sign here, and it allows me to edit the two items again. So if I click on the wedge and then go to callouts, what I can do is change the fill color, because I'm on the wedge now, and in callouts I can actually edit the live wedge. You can see it's highlighted. So let's change the color to something a little bit darker but similar. I'm not sure if I like that. In fact, I don't like it at all. Yeah, I like that one better, actually. I like that one better. And I might get rid of the shadow on that one. And now, let's just take a look a bit zoomed in. How does that look? I actually like that color better personally. Okay, but I don't quite like the position of the shape. So I'm going to split the group again with this plus sign. Click on the wedge, and what I want to do, that wedge there, I just want to move it a little bit over to the right. Let's have a look. Yeah, maybe not quite that much. I just want it a little bit, there we go, something like that, yeah? It was a little bit too off the screen for my personal taste. So I'm okay with that now. I'm happy with that. I've locked my group. I can reuse this. I can duplicate it. I can trim the edges just by pulling them back. You know, I can do all this kind of good stuff. The other thing I can do is reuse this in future videos, because if I'm promoting a particular website more than once with more than one video, I'm going to want the same kind of lower third. So although we've spent quite a bit of time talking about a simple lower third, I can reuse this now very, very easily. Because if I save this project, I can add different videos. I can just change out the media here, just put in a different media file, and I will still have my good stuff reviewed lower third. So this is a great way of saving time for the future, because once you've got it exactly how you like it, then you can reuse it time and time again. Now just think about what that means. That means you have a consistency of branding across all your videos, and that's important, because if people are viewing those videos, particularly if it's a sequence, then they'll get used to where things are, they'll know where to look, there's a certain familiarity. And if you look at adverts, they always have the logo in the same place, you know, the strap line or the advertising headline kind of thing, they put that in the same place for the same companies. It builds brand consistency. So rather than having to reinvent the wheel on every video, you've got this done, Okay, I'm going to pause for questions in a second because I want to show you something else about how to make yourself the authority in a video with a little trick that they use on news TV shows, discussion shows, adverts, yes, even on adverts. So let me just pause and take some questions. Ted's asking if you can make the text clickable. You can in Camtasia, but not, you can't do it directly in YouTube. You can put an overlay on YouTube, which occupies the same space as the text, and you can make that clickable. And that's a very powerful thing. I'm actually going to show you that a bit later, how to put a button that looks like a clickable button. But YouTube has the ability to put a shape overlay that's transparent, and you just put it wherever you want on the video, and you can make it clickable to go somewhere. So it's a kind of a two-step process. Just checking through your questions, so bear with me. Joseph, sorry if it's still clicking. Okay. Right, so how do we make ourselves the authority? Well, here we go. Let's just go back to the beginning. So at the beginning, I say, I'm Eamon Motin. Now, let me zoom in so I've got some working space. I'm going to move my lower third with my website branding over here so I've got some space to work on. Now, that disappears. Okay, let's just have a look. I'm making the introduction of my name just a little bit longer, and I'm probably, if I zoom in I can see what I'm doing, I'm probably going to make it fade out a little bit slower by dragging this. That was my fade out, if you remember, my gradient wipe. And I'm just hovering over the green, I get the double-headed arrow, click and pull a bit, and something like that. So let's see how long that takes to fade out. Still a bit fast, so I'm just going to make it a bit slower. Yeah, I like that personally. By the way, there's no rule about these speeds. You choose the speed you like. I just happen to like the speed that's doing that. So what that's got now is my name, which is cool. But let me show you something else we can do. So let's first of all make the text a little bit smaller so I've got room to do something else. Okay. So I just clicked on here to make it hit the top. It's vertically aligned, you can see at the top. You can make it middle aligned, you see how it's changed, or you can make it aligned at the bottom. I want it at the top to leave room for some other text. Okay. So let's say I'm on the gadget review kind of niche. Gadget review expert. Okay. And I'm just resizing so that the text appears. Now, if I select my text here, and I'm just doing that with the cursor key, I can change the font color, and let's have a look. I quite like that. Yeah, not bad. Looks kind of modern to me, that color, so I'm quite happy with that. So now let's have a look. Now, I can claim to be an expert on that. There's no qualification to be a gadget review expert. It's perfectly valid. You know, I wouldn't claim to be a medical expert. That's certainly wrong. But, you know, there are certain things you can claim to be in fairness. You might be, you know, 7-year YouTube marketing veteran. You might be, you know, YouTube reviewer. In fact, let me show you. Let's just change that to YouTube gadget reviewer, and then resize this. I'm just dragging this directly on the screen, as you can see, so that it fits. Now have a look how that appears. Hello, I'm Eamon Motin. I'm a YouTube gadget reviewer. Okay, that would be fine. Or I could say, and the wording you use here can have an impact on your branding in association with that message, that lower third. Watch and listen now as I change slightly what I say as that message appears. Hello, I'm Eamon Motin. I'm the YouTube gadget reviewer, and thank you for joining me today. All I did was said, I'm the YouTube gadget reviewer. Perfectly fine. And that instantly gives a credibility, because you have something that they use on news programs, they do it on interview panels, all that kind of thing, and people are used to that being the definitive statement, that lower third thing here, this thing, as being the definitive statement of who and what you are. Now, if you think about it, when you go onto a news channel and you see a lower third and they're introducing, spokesman for the Energy Commission or whatever it may be, most of us have never heard of these people in our lives, but that lower third immediately introduces that person as the expert. And I'm going to show you another thing in a moment where we could do that with like an interview and so on. But let me just check. I might have a question here. Hello, Ray. Yes, Ray, there will be. I'm recording this, so as long as nothing goes wrong, there will be a replay. Absolutely. We've only looked at one thing so far. I mean, there's a ton more to do, so I hope you can stay with me because I've got some really cool stuff to show you. So, now, what I want you to do is pretend that I'm actually doing a review in this video of skincare products, and I'm actually doing a telephone interview with somebody. Let me show you how to make somebody else the authority. And this is one of those weird tricks, because if you introduce somebody else as the authority, why should anybody listen to you? Because who are you? If nobody knows you, why should they listen to you? But you know what people do. In interview techniques, particularly if you have a news anchor asking somebody out in the field, so John, can you tell us please why this particular circumstance has arisen? And then this guy, John, that you've never seen before, starts telling you why he thinks this has arisen. And because the news anchor at the desk in the studio is asking the question, it automatically transfers authority to the person answering the question. So let me show you a little trick. When I say trick, by the way, I do mean a I actually mean a technique. I don't really mean a trick, but you'll see what I mean. Wrong guy, so let me just import all the media. So I've got some images here, and these are just from a stock library, so you'll see what I'm going to do with that in a minute. Let me just quickly check my questions. So let's make this a little bit smaller so it doesn't last as long. Eamon Motin, and I probably want to change that. Let's just change it to my name. Yeah, okay, and I'm going to click it and copy it, come over here and paste it. So I've got a copy of that for later. Right now I'm going to select my text and put it in the middle of the screen. Which it hasn't done, so let me just see what I've done wrong. There we go. Okay, so I'm introducing somebody. Hello, I'm Eamon, and today I'm going to be speaking to. So let me show you who I'm going to speak to. So I'm going to drop this image onto the timeline on track 3, or I can right click and add to the timeline at the playhead. I prefer to drag and drop because I can be more precise, and I can also put it on the track I want to. Let's just make a bit of space for working. So I'll drag this image and let go here and bring it up to about there. Far too big, of course, but you know, that's fine for the moment. We can deal with that later. And then on this thing here, which was my lower third, I've got my name, which isn't what I want. So I'm going to double click it, change the text. She looks like an Andrea Stevenson to me. I don't know why, but you know, she does. Skincare expert or skincare advisor. Okay, a skincare advisor sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Official. And again, I like that color personally, but you know, you choose whatever you want. So the image is obscuring her name. So if you remember the trick, if I bring this lower third higher up, it will appear on top of things underneath. You can see how I'm stacking the layers. And what I want to happen is the image first, so her image appears, and then I introduce who she is with the lower third. So let me just play that for you now. So here's me. So hello, I'm Eamon Motin, and today I'm going to be speaking to a guest, Andrea Stevenson, who is a skincare advisor from one of the major pharmaceutical companies, or whatever. Okay, now her image goes off too soon. So again, simple trick, let's just make it match the full size of the lower third. Watch that clip again. So we'll just go back a split second before she appears. So you kind of have to pretend you're listening to the audio and I'm saying I'm going to interview. So today I'm going to be introducing you to Andrea Stevenson, a skincare advisor from Max Factor or wherever. and there her name's disappeared. Cool. So all of a sudden, I'm giving authority to the person I'm introducing. That person could be me, because I could have somebody else introduce me. Think about that for a moment. When you're making your own video, if you're answering the questions, there is nothing to stop you having a friend or colleague introduce you as the person who is giving the answers. And therefore, they are passing the authority to you in your own video. That's perfectly fine. You know, as long as you're not lying about anything, you're not claiming to be a doctor, you know, as long as you're being truthful, it's okay to do that. Now, a trick for the image. I don't really like that there. It doesn't really, you know. I think what I will do, I'm going to have that appear there in the middle as I mention her. And then just as the lower third starts to kick in, which is here, okay. So let's just make it a bit sooner. Just as that starts to appear, I'm going to make the image move away. And I'll show you a trick for doing that. So we've got to choose where we want the image to appear. That's a bit late. That's a bit soon. So I think as soon as the name Andrea appears, there, I can see the word Andrea, I want that to move. So here's the way you make this move and synchronize it with that lower third introducing her. Click on her image. Click on More, click on Visual Properties, and you get this scary looking thing with all these options here. You can see there's a lot of options. Let's not worry too much about all of them, we're just going to use a couple today. Click on Add Animation, and it's put this funny looking symbol. And now drag this to where you want it to be, and resize it, and it will be like an anchor point for this particular command here. So let me do that. I'm going to resize it. And I'm going to move it over here. Let's say something like that. And I can change it later, okay? So now, when I'm introducing her, let's do the voiceover again. So today, I'm pleased to be speaking to Andrea Stevenson, who is a skincare advisor. Okay? So what I've got now, did you see how that worked? This thing here, when I clicked on Visual Properties, and add animation, allowed me to specify where I want that image to add up, and it will automatically resize it and reposition it for me from the beginning position, which is there, to the end position, which is where that funny blue thing is. I'm just going to zoom in so you can see. You see that blue thing there? Right. And the speed it goes at is determined by the length of this sort of greeny arrow. So let me show you that speed again, and then we'll change it so you can see the impact it might have. Now, actually, that's too soon, isn't it? Because it's actually, she's moving before we get to, you see she's moving before the name has appeared? So there's a real easy trick. I want her to start moving at that point, and if I just click on the yellow arrow here, or green, or whatever colour it is, I can drag it over to the right, and that little white dot there is the start point. Okay? So now, have a look at what happens. She starts moving as the name appears. I'm not sure that was quite where I wanted it, so I can play around. Yeah, it's too soon slightly. So again, I can move this ever so slightly, just a couple of frames, and by zooming in I can be quite precise. You know, I can do individual split seconds. So let's see what that looks like now. So her name begins to appear, and she gets moved. If I want it to be slower, I move that like that. So let's see how that looks now. And if I wanted it to be faster, I can drag it over to the left. So that makes it faster, that makes it slower. So let's just take a look. And again, you can do this and see what you think. I mean, that's probably too slow, so let me just put that there. I think something like this, and then I'm going to break for a second or two for your questions. There we go. Now, her name has gone there, and I think that was a very long gradient wipe, so I might just make that a little bit slower by dragging that over. And I'm also going to make her image disappear now. And I'm going to use the same trick. I'm going to go on More, Transitions, Gradient Wipe, because that's the last one I selected. It's remembered that for me. So I just click and drag that here. And watch what happens now. So there's her name and her title. It's going to disappear. And then a second after it disappears, she does as well. Now, if you don't like the gradient wipe, just click it and press delete and it's gone. You can put something else in. You could put a normal fade if you want. This is a normal fade. Let me show you what a normal fade looks like. So we'll start there. There's the name disappearing. And then she fades gently. Okay. And we can change the duration and speed by moving things around. If we move this, the track here, the blue, that changes the length of this segment. If we move this fade in and out, that changes the speed of the fade and the duration of this fade. And similar with this animation here. And we can combine these, remember. I can put this and this into a group. I've grouped them. And so now I have this wherever I want it. If I talk to this lady later on in the interview, if it was, say, a 30-minute, 40-minute interview, and in between I was talking to somebody else, like somebody who's used the product, I may be talking to her again later. If you think about documentaries in particular, when they have somebody come back and they're re-interviewing them, you know, a minute or two later on in the documentary, they will repeat the lower third with the person's name and information and occupation and so on to remind you of why you should listen to that person or who that person is and what it's all about. So here, let's zoom out, make a bit of space. If I want to, I can right-click on that group, copy it. I can go over to here, and let's just paste her into track 4. Okay, and now I get the same thing again. You see? So I can re-interview her. So now that I've spoken to a consumer of the product, I want to go back to Andrea Stevenson, and I'm going to ask her why this particular formula is so good at clearing up skin blemishes. Is that... You see what I mean? Now you notice my Good Stuff Reviewed there was actually interfering with that. So I can actually change it. I can hide it for the duration of Andrew Stevenson's lower third. That's not a real person, by the way. I'm just making up names. But because we've defined it here exactly the way we wanted, I can reuse it later in literally 2 seconds. So this is extremely efficient editing, because the 5 minutes you spend getting it just the way you like, you can reuse time and time again. And bear in mind, it may be that you're gonna... I'll just get rid of that for now. It may be that you're gonna put your branding on here again, and if you have multiple branding, you can you can alternate between, say, your website and your name and so on. Okay. And that way you can put a lot of information on screen. It's called overloading of information. And one of the benefits of doing that is that you don't know whether your site visitors are kind of, you know, reading a newspaper while they're listening to you. Some people listen to the audio on video and check their email while they're doing it. Other people will watch the video and follow along with the visuals. If you have multiple ways of presenting information, people can choose the type of information that they prefer. If they like to read things, they will see it on screen, they can read it. If they like images, they can have images, all that kind of good stuff. Okay, now we're coming up to an hour. That's kind of, 50 minutes. So what I'd like to do is show you another technique now. I'm going to take the lower thirds out for a moment, but I want to show you something about emphasizing your product if you're selling it. So let me just get rid of some of these because we don't need these anymore. So here we go. Now let's go to the clip bin and start importing some more images. So I've got a whole batch of things here, so let's have a look. This is a fake weight loss cover, and I've got some before and after, which I again is kind of fake. If I can find it, there we go. Okay, so I'm going to introduce in this video, let's say I've got a new ebook, or I'm an affiliate for a particular weight loss product and I want to emphasize how good it is. So let's start doing a couple of things. So, hello, I'm in blah 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 blah. Okay, let's put this image, the before image, on one of these tracks. Let's say here a few seconds in. I'm dragging it out to give me some space. So the image will appear, Okay, that's maybe a bit too big, or maybe you want it centered. Let's just move it to the left and make it slightly smaller. Okay, so what we're going to do is explain that there's a particular problem that people have. They can't lose weight very easily. So then we're going to show the after image here, which is how this particular person lost weight. And if we look at that, you'll see a lot slimmer, but still, we need to resize. Let's have a look. Yeah, so that's about matching, I would say. And I'm going to drag it over to the right, and you'll see why in a moment or two. So what we've got now is this. The image just suddenly appears, and then I talk about it. It's actually quite a long time. Let me just fast forward for you. So we'd be saying, if you've struggled with your weight loss in the past, there is a way to get around that. You don't have to diet the hard way. You can lose weight. And then you see the successful weight loss image. Cool. Pretty static, though. So let me show you a couple of tricks that you can do with images, which is really quite nice. So we take the before image. It's far too long, that, so I'm just going to make it a bit smaller. There we go. Now, what I want to do is go to Visual Properties, and let's say here, just before we get to the new image, the after image, I'm going to add an animation. I'm going to do this slowly because this takes a bit of thinking about. Add an animation. And what I want is this image now to be over on the right hand side. So I'll just drag it over. And I also want it to be flipped, so she's facing the other way. So if I remember rightly, is it minus 360 or just 360? Or is it 180 maybe? Yeah, there we go. So in this Y rotation here, I've put minus 180 and it's made her face the other way. Okay, so that's done. And what will happen now, if you watch this carefully, she's going to move over there and then suddenly flip around and face the other way. Oh, sorry, it's a long, long clip, so let me just start here. So we'd be saying something about weight loss and how you can get a new life, and here she goes, starting to move in a second. Okay. What did I forget to do? Oh, there we go, yeah. So let me just zoom in so I can actually see. Yeah, it's starting there. I wanted it to start sooner. Let me just drag this out. You remember, if we drag this out, we can have it start sooner. The little white dot is the start point. So watch that again. So she starts to move about now. And she's moving over there. I can make it faster if I want to. And she's also spinning. You notice how she's spinning? Hopefully you'll be able to see this on screen. And she's coming around to face the other way. That's probably a little bit slow, to be honest, but Okay, and she's finished. Great. So far, so good. And then all of a sudden, we get the new person, the after image, which is approximately in the same place, but a lot slimmer. So that was too slow, so let me make it like that. And I'm just, remember these little tricks for making the duration different just by dragging these sliders. And I'm going to pull this slightly in so that as soon as she's turned, she stops. Okay. And then I'm going to do something which will make sense in a moment. I'm going to click on that sort of bluish circle there. And what it does is it puts me back into the visual properties section so I can make changes. And what I want is for her to fade out completely at that point, roughly there. So if I zoom in with this little control here on the left, I can be precise to a frame. So I think what I would do is just move off that maybe one or two frames like this, and I can use this button here to go a single frame at a time, and then add a new animation, because I want the fade out to start after she's finished moving. So click animation and then change the opacity to zero. She fades out. Just have a look at what happens now. So she's going to move, stop moving, and then fade out. And the fade out's reasonably nice. You could make it a bit slower. You remember we can make things slower by dragging these out. This one was the fade, that one was the movement, if you remember. So let's just have a look at that fade out again. Yeah, I like that speed personally. Now over here, I'm going to put the after image here above, and that will actually, you'll see, just suddenly appear. I don't want it suddenly to appear like that. What I want to do is have her fade in. So I've selected this track. Okay. I've gone to the very beginning of the track. It's still selected because it's blue. And if I drag the opacity down to zero without adding an animation, that makes this entire track completely opaque and see-through. She's disappeared. Now here, if I move forward, about there I want her to appear, so I add an animation this time, and I bring the opacity back up to 100%. And now let's have a look how that looks, and then we can tweak. So let's just see. The larger lady stops moving and then disappears, and then the new lady comes in. Now there was a bit of a pause there before she appeared. If I want the one image to replace the other, I can drag this over, this second image, a little bit to the left so it's starting sooner. And I would say, do we want it to finish at exactly the same time as the other one does? Maybe. Let's have a look. That gives you kind of a cross dissolve. Let's have a look. See how it looks. So just move a little bit closer. There we go. So the first one's going to fade and the new one comes in. Now, I don't know if that transition works, I'm not sure. And also I think she probably needs to be a little bit further back. Let's just have a look one more time. But you can see it's very easy to change these things. I think that transition could be a little bit slower, so I'm going to just drag that over. That makes it slower. That's all I needed to do, remember. Let's have a look again. I just want to see if it's better with a slower transition. Yeah, I kind of like that. I prefer the slower transition. Okay, so what I've done now with just a couple of images, this isn't even video now, so let's pretend I'm doing the voiceover again. So in this special report, what I want to tell you about today is how to end the struggle that you have had with dieting. I know you've had this struggle all your life, so have I. I've lost nearly 200 pounds in the last year, and I've done it in a way that most of you would not believe. I'm going to reveal the secret for losing that weight in a moment, but right now you can see my before picture, and I'm a blonde girl for some reason. Here's the after image, and you tell me if I look better or not. Well, it's pretty clear I lost a lot of weight. Okay, so what we've got there is a voiceover emphasizing the before and after. Does that make sense? Hopefully it does. Now let's pretend. Let's just pretend for the sake of argument I have an ebook. That it's a silly one. Okay, I'm going to admit to you, this is a silly ebook that I just did a quick cover for fun. Let me find it. There we go. So this is not a real diet, okay, by any stretch of the imagination. It's this thing here. So let me zoom out so you can actually see what I'm doing. I'm going to take this image and I'm going to drop it onto the timeline where I want it. And I would say probably a bit more than halfway after we get the after shot, where I'm this person's slim. So I'm going to drop it onto its own track, and that means I can work on it separately, resize it, put effects and so on, without affecting other things too much. And then I can group it with the before and after if I want to, and that way I can build up the effects in layers and then lock them down so that I can reuse them later on. Because in a good advert, you'll see certain things repeated, particularly if it's important information. I mean, early on, I'm saying I've lost weight here. Here's the special diet. Later on at the call to action stage, the end of the video, when you're trying to get somebody to take an action, you'd want to repeat it then as well. So there's the image. Bit big, really, and in the wrong place. So let me just move it over and resize it, something like that. I'll make it quite small so you can't see it. And as we go along, it stays there like that, and It's a small cover. So as she disappears, I want it now to start taking center stage and be very easy to see. So what I've done, you can see how it clicks into position when I move this. This is called the scrubbing cursor. When I move this on the timeline, I'm now at the end of that particular section, her after image. And so if I click the Sweet Life cover here, I can go to Visual Properties, Add Animation, and resize this, just drag it out to where I want it. Yeah. And that's done. So watch this now. So in a few seconds, I'm about to reveal to you the secret that allowed me to lose 200 pounds and still eat sweet foods. When you see this diet, you'll think it's a new fad diet, but it isn't. It's the most remarkable diet you will ever see in your life. And it's called the Sweet Life No Diet Diet. Okay, that's a bit slow, but you can see we could adjust the timing. And that's going to start zooming in now. So there we go. So that was too slow. So all I would do, let me just show you again. For my voiceover, because I could have an audio track on here, for my voiceover, I could see where I'm speaking. Let's say it was this point here. Can you see? You can see where the silence is because it's a, you know, thin line, and then the speech would be here. So if I drag this over to where the speech would be, let's say there, then it starts to zoom in as I'm speaking. Okay? And she disappears. And I can make her disappear, you know, at that point just by dragging this over. So we'd get something like this. She's there. We've got the image of the Eve cover. And then, as I'm saying, it's a Sweet Life No Diet Diet. Boom, you've got your recover there. Now that's cool. So far so good. We've shown the e-cover, we've emphasized it. Let me just drag this down so you can see it a little bit better. And I wish there were a diet like this, but there isn't, I'm sure. I just, you know. Chris is saying he's taking a little break, he's going to get a cupcake. I wish you could bring me one, Chris, that would be great. But it's just for fun, is that e-cover. Now, I can do a little bit more with that cover. Okay, as I start to talk about other things, I'm going to show you actually with a camping site in a minute, so you'll see even more. Once I'm happy with that position there, and I know I'm talking, so you know I'm going to tell them about what's in the Sweet Life diet and the fact that it's safe or whatever. It isn't, but you know. I may want it to disappear. So let's say about here, I want that to disappear because I'm going to do a voiceover facing the camera. You're actually going to see me. Let's say I'm going to do a face to camera and talk about, you know, how it's affected my life. Actually show them me live, slimmer than I was. To get rid of this now, if I click on the actual image here, and remember what we can do is, you know, put the track names so we know what they are. I'm going to call that e-cover, okay, so I can remember. If I go to Visual Properties again, and sometimes you have to click on more to find it, but sometimes, you know, if you're using it, it's going to be here, but sometimes it will disappear. If I go to Transitions, you see it's disappeared, so I click on More, Visual Properties. Add an animation, and now here's another little trick that you can do to give impact to a fairly static video. Let me show you. What I'm going to do is move this off screen. I need to zoom in so I can see what I'm doing. Okay, so I'm going to make it smaller and get it over here. And I'm also going to rotate it. Okay, and I think I'm going to go for 180. Okay, and if we look at that now, that's probably too short an animation, so I better make that a little bit longer. So let's just see what that looks like to make it smoother. So that's where it is now. And then as I'm about to do my face to camera, have a look at that. And it stopped there because I've made it stop there. In fact, I should have gone further, shouldn't I? So let me just double click. I'm double clicking on that little blue circle there, which reopens the animation window so I can change the settings for this. And what I want to do, in actual fact, I'm going to make it minus 360, which just makes it rotate clockwise. And I think, is that right? Oh, actually, no, I needed it to be 180. I would have had to do it in two sections. Let me just put it back to 180. But I'm going to make it move off screen and perhaps be a little bit smaller as well, so it's completely gone. Now let's have a look at that. I'll show you what it's done. So we start to say, now I'm going to show you me my before and after, and it's rotating and disappeared and gone. So just have a look at that again, because that's a very quick effect to do, but it's quite swish. Okay, and it's an e-cover, it could be a software box, it could be a physical product that you're promoting on Amazon, it can be anything you want it to be. Okay, now remember what I said about these little animations here. You can make them slower or quicker, you can make them start sooner. Just by dragging that, it makes it start sooner, and because it's lengthening this, it makes it slower. Let's have a look at this now. If we just make it quite slow, and you'll see the effect, and that probably would be a bit too slow for me, but you know, yeah, I think that would be too slow personally, but it's done, and that would actually de-emphasize the ebook. Now what I've got, let's zoom in so you can see what I'm doing. I've got an after image and a before image and an ebook cover and a transition. Okay, let me just trim this for a second. If I click them and then press Control and click them, they all turn blue, so I can right click and turn them into a group, and I now have another group okay, that allows me to duplicate that entire effect later on in the video. So let's just see, where would we put that? Yeah, so let's do this, copy, paste. So I've got the image here. So, you know, I'm mentioning about ebooks and weight loss and so on. You can see this lady's moving now very slowly. And she's going to do that little spin in a second. So that entire thing, let me just speed this up because it's, yeah, there we go. That entire thing is running the whole sequence that I've created. I've locked it down into a single group. So all the individual elements, and I had three of them, take place in the same sequence. Okay, and if I just fast forward a little bit there, and then we'll see the ebook appear in a second or two. So all of a sudden the ebook appears and she disappears. Should be coming in now. There we go. I'll just let that play for a second so you can see it, and then we've got the same thing later on to emphasize the point again. There we go. And here we have exactly the same thing. By the way, these editing lines don't appear in the video. They're just for me to see where the boundaries are so that I can move things around. And you can also do something which is slightly unethical, but let me show you. If I click on the plus and ungroup the group, you can see the three items again. Click on this one, which was the before image. Position the cursor here. With these boundary handles, these are called boundary handles, I can actually distort the image. So watch what happens if I use this center one and pull it out to the side. See, I mean, that would be a little bit deceptive, wouldn't it? But you know, you could make it look slim again, or you know. So you can adjust and distort images as well. I don't want to on that particular example because it, you know, it wouldn't really suit. So now what we've seen is emphasizing an e-cover. Okay, let me just pause and see if there's any questions. And what we'll do, we'll take a moment or two for a break. Thank you, Ted, for reminding me. For those of you who can stay with me, please do so, because there's a lot more to come. But let's just take a 2 or 3 minute break in case you need some water or you need to go to the bathroom or whatever, and then meet back here. I'm getting a question. Anybody who's staying on, that's fine, I'll keep talking. But if you need a break, you know, take a break now and come back in a minute or two. Ted's asking, what are the something and green tabs? I'm not sure what the RID means, Ted, and I'm not sure which green tabs you mean. I'm colorblind, so I'm not sure what you mean by green tabs. Which ones do you mean, Ted? Red and green tabs. Oh, I see that. Yes, sorry, okay. This particular thing called the scrubber allows you to edit clips on the timeline. So let's say I get to here and that particular bit was boring. What I can do, it's start and beginning this effectively, is drag this out to the bit I want to get rid of. Let's say it's that. And if I wanted to change the start of the clip where I'm editing, I can move it back and forward. So I get a start and end of the segment. And I can then cut that entire segment out and get rid of it quite easily. It's a way of highlighting a particular section for editing. I can edit with cutting. I can also edit the audio for that particular section. If you just have a look down here at the bottom, if I zoom in, you might see better. I've got audio there. Let's say in that particular audio I had some noisy music or something I didn't want to hear. By selecting that section, clicking on audio, okay, I can then put the volume up, down, fade in, fade out. I can make it silent. If you watch what happens to the waveform here, only this section between red and between green and red will be affected. So if I click silence, you see how that's silenced it? So you can use that to affect just a particular subsection of your audio or video or even your images. Okay, so that's what these do. So let's just come back so we can see that. So we've got a couple of different things going on here. We've seen the landing page. That's a great way to put authority on your site. We've seen a little trick with images where you can move them about, so you can emphasize them like this, and hopefully you can see this. I'm scrubbing it through fairly quickly. Now, let's get near the end of the video, and we'll go to the clip bin. I'm just going to pause for a moment or two, and hopefully everybody will rejoin us so that we are not losing anybody. I'm just going to check email as well. Can I show the copy technique for repeating the call out? Absolutely, I'm going to show you that. That was a question that was sent by email. So, let me just make this so that you can see what I'm doing. So the technique for different things is, let me just split this group. So I now have a group, actually if I ungroup it would be better, wouldn't it? Ungroup. So with each of these I did a different thing and I've copied and pasted, yeah? If I want to repeat the before image, I select it by clicking once on the actual track representation here. I can then right click and choose copy. Then move this sort of triangular thing here to where I want to paste in the new copy. And then right click and paste, and it's copied that image there for me. And it's copied also anything that was set on that image, like that animation. Okay, so that's copy and paste. I can copy groups in the same way. Click on the group, right click, copy, position it where you want it, right click, paste, and you've got a group there. I'm just going to get rid of that because I didn't really want it, but the copy and paste will work on anything. You know, if you just click on the item you want to copy, right click it, copy, and then, you know, paste where you want. Now, the reason that's important is that when you're building these up, particularly at first, you're going to have to tweak a little bit with the timings, and you're going to have to think, you know, does it fade in too fast or whatever. At the point where you're happy with the speed, you're happy with when it appears and so on, you can then group it, which I did, by click once there, press Control, click there, keep Control pressed down, click there. All three are highlighted now. Or if you prefer, you can just left click and drag over them. And then once they're all selected, the ones you want to keep together, right click and then click on group. And you see there's a Control and G shortcut as well, but you can use the mouse, whichever you prefer. And they're now grouped. And because you've grouped them, all the editing you did is now fixed, and you can copy that as many times as you need to. So, let me just check a couple of other questions because I've got some more in there. Here's a good question from Alan. Does GIMP, which is Graphical Image Manipulation Program, it's a free kind of Photoshop equivalent. Does it compare to Camtasia? Not really. It's not the same. Not the same thing, actually. You can't really compare it. No, to be fair. Okay. So hopefully everybody else is back with us now. So what I want to do is add another piece of media, and I've got a button somewhere, which, let's have a look, register now. So let's just put that in there and pull this down a little bit. So here we've got an image. Where's it gone? Register now. So let's say I'm talking about weight loss or whatever it may be. And towards the end, I've got a call to action where I'm asking people to do something. Now, whether this is on your own site or whether it's on YouTube, you can do the same technique I'm about to show you. But with YouTube, you also get an extra, which allows you to make the image clickable. So I'm going to drag this image here down to track 3, just to keep it, you know, on its own. And that currently, the default setting is 5 seconds for images. So it will appear for 5 seconds, then disappear. I actually want it to appear to the very end of the video. And you notice how it's jumped. I got that yellow line. It's lined up for me. That's cool. So at this point, I've got an image in the middle of the screen, smallish. So what I'm going to do, let's just zoom down a little, make some space to work. First thing I'm going to do, you notice that this is blue, so that means I'm working on that particular image, that particular track. I'm not touching the others. I'm going to drag it down here, okay, and I'm going to make it a little bit smaller. And I'm also going to change the visual properties and make it absolutely opaque, see-through. You can't see it's there. Now I'm going to move forward a little bit, let's just say a second or two. I've got to click on here to select the image. And I'm going to add an animation. And the animation I'm adding is for opacity back up to 100%, so you can see it. And I want to zoom this so it's really big and bold and in your face, really obvious. I mean, that's pretty obvious, isn't it, really? Let's just make it centered. There we go. So that's centered now. So have a look how that appears. So this is what it looks like with that little bit of animation. And this is at the end of the video where I'm inviting the user to do something. Let's click play. And what will happen is in a second or two, it will start to appear and start to resize and start to move. I possibly need to change the speed of the animation because the standard speed is a bit slow. Yeah, that is a bit slow. Okay, so let me just stop that. And because I'm working on this, I want to see what I'm doing. So I'm going to zoom in with this thing here. It's just easier for me to see what I'm doing, you know. So I'm going to drag this so it starts sooner. That white spot here is the starting point of the animation. And I'm going to make it take a little bit longer. So let's have a look. Maybe even start sooner than that. Let's see. Okay, let's see how that looks. Just drag it down again. So we're watching here. Let's see when it starts to appear. And then when it starts to appear, it should start moving. Okay, and that's probably too slow, in fact. So I could make it faster. But you can see the impact. Yeah. And we're done. Okay, so that was way too slow for my taste. So, dead simple to change. Remember, I can drag this thing here, this arrow, and that changes the speed. Now, I'm just guessing at the speed here, but, you know, you can make it take a specific number of seconds. You've got a second marker up here, this ruler. So, you know, you can actually see that it starts there, which is 734. You see this number here? That's the starting point of this arrow, this scrubber here, is at 734, and it finishes at 743. So that's what, 9 seconds? Ooh, that's a long time. Let me drag it back a bit. Let's say from 734 to no more than 4 seconds, so that would be 738. And what I'm doing is dragging my slider here until I see 738 there, and now I just drag this back to match that line. So watch now, this will appear in 4 seconds now, and the full thing will be done in 4 seconds. 2, 3, 4. Okay, there you go. So yeah, I think that was a suitable speed, and that's great. And what we would do then, you'd actually say something like, so if you want more information about this, click on the button now on screen, register now, it's completely free. You'll get your ebook within the next couple of minutes and start losing weight tomorrow. You know, that kind of a sales pitch. Now, what you do on YouTube, I don't know if I'm going to have time to log in and show you. What you do on YouTube when you've uploaded your video is you can scrub forward, you can fast forward to the point where this appears, and then in YouTube you can actually, there's a button that says add link, and you can put like a different types, you can have a note, you can have a rectangle, various things in there, and you just drag it over that shape and then specify the URL you want people to go to if they click on that. And what will happen is they will see this image, will be a hidden button that YouTube put on there, and when they click on that hidden button it will look as if they're clicking on this actual image, and it will take them to where they're, you know, wherever you've wanted to send them. Okay, a couple of questions, let me just pause. Ted's asking, can you do the same thing with Adobe Premiere Elements? Yes, the tools are different, so you use different things, but you can do the same thing. Susan, absolutely, I will show you how to group the tracks. I'll do that right now. And thanks for that comment, Susan. So Adobe Premiere Elements and Adobe Premiere Pro are slightly more sophisticated, but they have ability to add images and rotate them and use a timeline and transformations and so on. It's just that the tools are called something different, but the same principle applies. And once you know that a lower third can be made up of rectangles that you just position where you want them to be and so on, it's just find the rectangle tool. Okay, so let's just zoom out, and Susan wanted to see how to group things. So what I'm going to do, let me just ungroup this. So the group, by the way, doesn't have to overlap like this. You could have a group, you know, that literally does anything you want it to. So let me move this one further on and move this one further on. So there's actually a gap between each of these, okay? And just for the sake of making it easier to demonstrate, I'm going to make them quite short so that it doesn't take too long to play. Okay. Now if you notice, there's a gap between each one. So if I play this now, if you look up here, watch what happens. So it's still probably a bit longer than it should be, but you'll get the idea in a second, and you'll see the gap. She'll disappear, there'll be a gap, the new girl will appear, there'll be a gap, and then the ebook will appear. Okay, I should have made the whole thing faster. Okay, she's gone, the new girl hasn't appeared yet, she's about to start in a second or two, she's going to appear. Okay, so the point I'm making really is that whatever you're linking together, they don't have to be contiguous, they can be separate elements if you want to. So there are two ways to group these. You can do the first way, which is click on the first one, press and hold control, click on all the others that you want, and that makes them all turn blue, and then you right click and add to group here, or press Ctrl and G, and you've got a group. Let me just ungroup them. I've just right clicked and we ungroup. Okay. The second way, if the elements that you're wanting to put together are close, you know, nicely positioned, you can drag your mouse button down, left button, and make what they call a marquee. You see how it's gone blue? Over the elements that you want to group together. But you have to be careful. If you go too far, you group too many. So you do have to be careful, and they do have to be reasonably close together. Okay? Right click, group, and it's done. A right click on group, let me just show you. Now, if I wanted these three and that one, if I were careful, I could do the marquee thing. But, you know, the click, control, click, control, click, control, click is a very precise way. So if you have elements that are kind of all over the place, you may find that easier. One other trick I should show you, when you're working on your timeline, let me just drag this up. You see this thing here, I can make the video smaller, so I've got more space. If I need more space for this vertically, I can drag this up so I can see what I'm doing. And particularly, particularly on audio, if we drag this up, I can see the waveform more easily. And then with this horizontal zoom, I can get really, really precise. I mean, look at that. You're talking about literally being able to talk about one frame at a time, and that's moving forward one frame at a time with this little button here. When you're done, zoom back out, drag this back down, and then you can check your video by playing it and seeing it a sensible size. Okay. So what you'll do as you're editing you're going to zoom in and out from time to time so you can see what you're doing, because if you can't see what you're doing, you'll make mistakes like I do. Question, let me pause. 1 second. I don't think there's a question there actually. I'm just checking, there's another one here. Now, Susan was asking, how do you make the register now button clickable? You would do that in YouTube itself. And in YouTube, you can use something called annotations, where you can overlay clickable items on your video. And what you would do is overlay a transparent box. Let me just zoom to that point. You'd overlay a transparent box that covers this entire area. Because it's transparent, they won't see it, they'll just see this image. And therefore, when they click the transparent annotation box, it will look as if they're clicking the register now, and it will take them to the page or website that you want them to go to. So you would do that actually in YouTube itself. Okay, I'm getting asked how to set up the YouTube clickable button. So what I'm going to do, you're going to have to bear with me, because I'm going to have to log into YouTube to do this. So let me just do that. I'm going to have to open a new browser, so bear with me, I'll do that for you, but I've got to open a new window and do some logging in. Okay, let me sign in. Okay. No, I've signed in as the wrong person, so let me sign in as the correct one. I've got several YouTube accounts, just let's do this. Okay. Right, as soon as I get into YouTube, I'll find a video and I'll show you about this annotation thing. So, let's have a look. Well, I've got some messages there that I haven't responded to. Okay. So in a second or two, I'll actually switch to a video. Yeah, okay. Here's one. Just stop it. Okay, I'm going to drag this over now. And come back to the main screen. So hopefully you can all see that. I'll give it a second or two to catch up so that you can all see it. I've got a video, I'm logged in, and this is a particular video which I've paused. Now if I scroll down, there's all these things that we can do here, okay? But this is the one that I'm interested in. So let's do annotations. And what it's doing, let me just pause that again, is showing me the video and a timeline. I might be able to zoom out so you can see this slightly better, I don't know. No, I can't zoom out. Okay, so I'll keep moving it around so you can see. But I've got a timeline there, and what I want to do is find the point at which I would have a button. Let's say it's here, for argument's sake. Okay, and it's moved on the timeline to here. You see, it's just about 7 minutes, 7 minutes and 1 second. So at that point, let's say I want to add an annotation, and I'm doing that from here. Okay. So can you all just confirm that you're seeing this, because I want to make sure you see how to do this. Alec is asking if PowerPoint can do something similar. Yeah, PowerPoint can do animations, and you can move things from one position to another. So yes, you can, absolutely. There are lots of different tools that you can use for video. I'm showing you Camtasia because I know a lot of you have it, and I know most of you, based on what people tell me, don't use even 20% of the power of Camtasia. If you learn how to do something in 2 minutes that can make it look really cool on screen, you're more likely to do it every time. And bear in mind, you can reuse these things once you've got a really nice effect and you've got it the timing you want and so on. So if you can just confirm for me that you're seeing the screen, and then I'll continue, because I want to make sure you all see this. Cool, you can see, great. So the add annotation, we've got all these things here, and I want to use the spotlight, and it's positioning it at 7 minutes 1 second. Okay, and if you see on screen here, I've got some size bars, these little grey circles. You might not be able to see them, hopefully you can see them there. Okay, and if I resize this, what I would do in this example, I'm going to make it the size of the camera. Okay, there we go. Then click on the link. So you'd have to pretend that I put the image there, you know, that register image that I showed you. Just pretend it's there. I'm using the camera, but pretend it's there. Then click on link, right? And then put in whatever link you're wanting to put in there, okay? So let's say you're linking to another video or another channel or whatever. And then open the link in a new window if you want to do all that kind of a thing. And here is where we get to specify how long that will stay on screen. So you see these little sliders? It's the same thing. You can see we've got a double-headed arrow. So you can just make it last the rest of the video. And so if they click on that, it'll take them to where you've specified. So the annotations here, you can put speech bubbles, notes. So even if you've put some I was going to say landing pages, I mean lower thirds on your video in Camtasia, you can also edit in YouTube as well, but you're generally better to do the editing outside of YouTube because you get a higher quality, sharper images and so on. So let me just show you what I did to do that. If I go back, I found my channel, looked at my videos, found the video that I wanted to change, which was this one, clicked on it. I'm just going to pause it for a moment, okay? And then on here, that takes me to the annotations page, okay? And then you just add the one you want. And that's for YouTube, okay? So if you're playing this directly on your website without going through YouTube, it's not going to be clickable. Oh, look, I'm talking. Let me stop that. Just stop that for a second. But if you're doing this within Camtasia, it is possible to have a clickable region if you output the entire HTML block from Camtasia. Camtasia can output a special section of code that will make that clickable for you. So you've got, you know, like, let's just have a look at this one. So, what I've done, I've double-clicked on that image, which gives me the properties. And at the bottom here, I can make it a hotspot. And the hotspot properties are jump to that URL and open in a new browser. So I can make that clickable if I use the code from Camtasia. So it is possible, but then you have to do a little bit of extra work to get it working on your site if you're using a blog. So it depends on the kind of site you have. I mean, you can actually make these clickable directly within Camtasia, but integrating the code that you get with a blog just takes a little bit more work. It's probably easier, to be honest, to output the video, render the video, upload it to your YouTube channel, and then do it that way. Okay, so any questions, because there's some more that I want to show you. I'm going to show you a bit more in a second, and I'm going to get rid of these for now, okay, because I want to show you another little technique that's all to do with your sales pages, your website and so on. Okay, let me just get a load of stuff in the clip bin here. So we'll get rid of these because I don't need these anymore. I'll get rid of that and I'll import the media. So let's have a look. Yep. Okay. Yep, I'll open all those. So now I'm going to show you, this is actually an ebook that was done for handsoffebooks.com. It was done as a demonstration ebook, but if you were promoting this particular ebook and you had a website to go with it, here's a couple of ways that you can do it. What I've done is I've taken some images of the ebook itself and also of the actual the site. So here's the image of the website, and I'm actually going to get rid of me, by the way, so let's get rid of me. So I'm going to put this down here as track one. Let me just make it, you know, a couple of minutes long. And that is the ebook squeeze page. Now probably I guess it would want to be a bit bigger. Let me just zoom in a little bit so it covers the full screen. Yeah, something like that, okay? So that's the squeeze page from the website. And you can see it looks quite attractive. It's a static image, so I'm making a video with static images. I'd need some audio, sure, But it's an easy way to make video if you know, if you don't want to do live action video with you as the star of the video, this is an easy way to do it. Now, the ebook is for sale. What we can do is highlight what's in the ebook without giving away the entire, without giving away the farm. So let me show you how you do that, because one of the ways you can gain trust with people is to show them what they're getting, but you don't want to show them everything because then they're not going to pay you for it. Right? So it's kind of, there's a fine line between giving everything away and not showing good faith with people. So what I've done is, let me find the e-cover. Where's the e-cover? Have I got the e-cover? Oh, it shows there, yeah, that's all okay. So I've taken a screenshot of the PDF of the contents page. So let me drag and drop this, say, here, and just take it a little bit bigger. I'm going to zoom in so you can see what I'm doing. So we'll make it somewhere around the 15 seconds where it starts. So we do voiceover for 15 seconds saying, welcome to my site. This is the essentials for any camping trip. In this book, my ebook, I'm going to tell you about blah, 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 blah. And then when we get to here, I've got an image of the table of contents. And again, it's probably a bit small, so let me just make it a bit bigger. I'm using a trick, by the way, to zoom in here. I've highlighted the image or track that I want to zoom in and make bigger. I'm pressing the control key, and on my mouse I have a scroll wheel. Watch what happens when I scroll up or down. You see, it can make it bigger. And I want this to be fairly easy to read. So let's say like that, and just bring it down to there. Okay, so that's great, but it's static. So what I would do on a voiceover is I'd say, here's just a small taste of what is in the book. Okay, and then I'd start reading out the table of contents. So let's do that again. Here's just a small sample of what's in the ebook. Now, at this point, I want to emphasize each individual chapter heading. So what I'm going to do is a call out. Now, let me show you these call outs because this is pretty cool. So I'm going to add a call out, and then I'm going to choose the one I want. So the one I want in this drop-down list here is down at the bottom, and it's this thing here, which is, they call it the spotlight, but it emphasizes certain sections of the screen. You see what I mean when I do this. And if I now drag this over to the text that I want to emphasize, okay, what it will do is emphasize that text, and it makes the rest a little bit blurred. And I can fade this in so we get a nice effect, and I can fade it out maybe a little bit longer. How many seconds you fade it in and out, that's your choice really. And then we've got intensity. Just have a look at intensity. What happens here when I change the intensity? You can make it as dark as you like to focus just on the bit you're talking about. So now, let's do that again. Let me show you that voiceover that we'd be talking about. Here's just a small sample of the contents of this ebook. In the introduction, I tell you that preparation is the key to successful camping. Now, what I'm going to do is drag this here, this image, to give me some working space. I don't know how long I'd be talking, so I'm just giving myself plenty of space, okay? And then I'm going to do the same with this, because I want this to end when I've finished talking. So I'm just dragging it out to the same length. Is everybody with me on that? I hope so. So what I've got now is these finish at the same time. So if I've finished talking here, and I've got the voiceover, so I know that that's when I've finished talking. Remember, I can check the audio if I have audio. I now want this to highlight the next item. So because I've selected Spotlight 1, that's this call out, it's in blue as you can see. If I add a visual property, I can do an animation, and I can drag this down. So I'm just going to click on it, oops, there we go, and drag it down to the old school camping checklist. Now watch what will happen. Let me come back here. So I'm talking about the introduction. Watch what happens to this call out. So when we get to the animation point, that call out will automatically move down for me, and now I'm telling you about the old school camping checklist. Then I add another animation. Click on this. Move it down for what's new. You can use the mouse or you can use the arrow keys. If you want to be very precise, if you use the arrow keys, you click on it here in the editing window and then use the arrow keys. You can go up and down one pixel at a time, so you can be really nice and precise. So now watch that again. So I'm telling you about the introduction. Preparation really is the key to successful camping. I needed to separate those. Did I add? Yeah, I forgot to add it, didn't I? So let me just back off. What I'm doing, I'm just getting rid of that. Let's do that again. So add animation, which I'm going to take to there. And then let's say here we add another animation, and I'm going to take that down to there. And then let's say we finish the voiceover here, we do another animation, do that one. So let's just have a look at those. And you know, you'd match these to the actual speed of what you were saying and so on. But what it's doing is emphasizing the content from your ebook, and you're not giving anything away because chapter headings are just chapter headings. So you're actually showing people. I mean, have a look at that screen, how much it appears to have. There's lots of chapter headings, and I have even more than that, so I can show even more later. If I go to my clip bin, I've got even more. I've got this thing here, contents 2, contents 3, contents 4. So if I wanted to, I could emphasize it with a close-up. Let me just show you what I mean by that. You see? So I've got those four highlighted if I wanted to. That's just a different screenshot. I'm going to get rid of it because I quite like this effect though. Okay, so we're telling people about it, and you know, now let me say, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the first chapter. So let's go over here. I'm dragging this one, which is a screenshot of the first chapter of the PDF. Okay, I'm dragging it down to here. Let's zoom it out so I've got some working space. And now I'm going to talk about protecting yourself from the sun. But let's say I don't want this bit to be on show, because that's giving information away that's more than I want to share. So I'm happy with the first paragraph. So what I'm going to do is select this and do some callouts. Now I'm going to add a callout again, like we did before. It's automatically remembered the spotlight one, because that's the last one we used. So I'm going to pull the spotlight to highlight the bit that I'm interested in, because I'm happy to show them this bit, okay? And probably I'll leave the fade in and out as it was. There we go. And then I'm going to add another call out. Now watch this. Because you can kind of read that, can't you? In fact, maybe I'll just add the call out, which has added another one. But this time I'm going to make it a blur and drag it down to here and just resize it. So I'm blurring all that and changing the blur intensity to, I quite like that personally, because it, you know, it shows that I've blurred it deliberately and you can't really read anything. So what it looks like now, if I make that the full width, let's just go to here a second before. Now what I can do is tell them about the first chapter. I can give a sneak preview, a teaser, a taste of the book I'm trying to sell them or get them to sign up for, whatever I'm doing. So let's play that and just see how it looks. Let me make it so you can see it. There we go. Excuse me. And there you go. So we'd just talk that through. We'd say, you know, here's a small sample from chapter 1, which is all about protecting yourself from the sun. You see, in the early days of camping, most people would just use a hat and a little bit of zinc oxide, and that worked, but time has moved on since then. In the rest of this chapter, we tell you about the more sophisticated methods that you can use today to keep your skin in good condition, avoid skin cancer and melanoma. There's a great deal of information. So you see, what we've done is we've tempted them, and now actually that I've zoomed in, I can see that that's actually readable. So what I'm going to do, remember we put this blur? If I select it here, it's come back here for me, so I can change the settings. And I'm actually going to make the intensity a bit higher, because I don't want that to be readable. Let's just something like that. There we go. Okay. So you see, it's very easy to change the effects once you've got them in place. It's literally the moment of a couple of seconds' work. And what I've got now is the squeeze page showing from my website. So that would actually visually match if I'm putting this on my squeeze page as a video. They would see what's right in front of them. So there would be a consistency of branding again. I then talk about the chapter one, which is about protecting yourself. And now let's go back and let's have a look. Yeah, so at the end of here, what I might want to do is talk about that there is no risk. So I've taken a screenshot of the guarantee from my squeeze page. So I'm going to drop that in here, give myself some working space, because I don't know how long I want it to be on screen at the moment. I can make this last, or, you know, as short as I want later. So just for the moment, I want working space. So there's the image of the money back guarantee. I think what I would do with that probably, go to the beginning of the clip. You see it's still blue, so I'm at the beginning of that clip and I'm affecting that clip, that image, and you can even see I've got these size bars, these handles. I would probably put it further down, so let me just do that and have it come off the screen and move in. And then about here, I would want it to be showing. So I'd go to Visual Properties, Add Animation, and I'd actually move it up. So let's just do that. You can do it from here, you can do it from there. You know, there's a couple of different places you can move it. Let me just move it up to... yeah, I'd move it to there. So let's just do that then. So this is what it would look like, and I'm going to change my timings because we've been using short timings previously. So let's have a look how that appears now. So in a second this will start appearing, and the guarantee, which is very important for getting people to trust you, can be emphasized in the video that appears on the site that is promoting the ebook itself. Now that's too slow for me, but you might like it. And when it stops, I'll show you another little trick. So you can see that there is absolutely no risk to you because I'm giving you a full 100% ironclad, no questions back, money back guarantee. And at this point I'm going to say it lasts for 90 days. So what I want to do is have that zoom out. So now, because that's where I would say it, I'm going to go to Visual Properties, Add Animation, and I want to zoom in. That's the scale thing here. And then I'm going to drag this over because I want to emphasize the 90 days. I might even make it bigger, you know, something like that. Yeah. Kind of want it to be center, yeah. I don't like this at the end, that's why I'm just thinking about the size. And this is just, you know, whatever you want it to be. In fact, look at that, that's pretty big, isn't it? That's, yeah, something like that. So, here we go. So we'll go back and we'll do that voiceover. So the ebook will appear. So I'm giving you a money back guarantee. An absolute cast iron money back guarantee. There is no risk on you. I am taking the risk. This is 100% ironclad, no questions asked, money back guarantee, and you have 90 days to claim your money back. Okay, so the voiceover would have needed slightly different timing, and I might need to do that sooner. But what you can see if we go here, I emphasize the 90 days, if that's what I want to emphasize. I might prefer to emphasize that it's no questions asked, you know? And I can do that now. So I've emphasized 90 days. I've stopped there. I'm still selected because this is blue, remember. I go to Visual Properties, Add Animation. And now all I'm going to do for the animation is drag this over to emphasize that it's 100% ironclad. So now this is what this looks like. So I've got the 90-day thing there. Boom, I've zoomed in. absolutely 100% ironclad, no questions asked, money back guarantee. And what I've done is emphasize some of the selling points just from a static image. And I've used this thing called animations to give me some life to that static image. If you've noticed, what we've done today has been, everything has been to do with animations to give life to your lower thirds, to your name, to your ebook cover. Okay. And then let's have a look what else we've got in the clip bin. Watch now. Or yeah, okay, here's a nice one. So I've got an image here, a blank image. So what I'm going to do, just make some space for myself. I'm going to create a new track by clicking here. Pull up so I can see what I'm doing. I'm going to drag this down to here. Resize it so I've got some working space. Okay. And I want this money back guarantee to stay on the screen, so I'm just going to drag it to match the size of that clip. And I now want some text over that clip. So what I can do is add a call out. So let's click on add call out, and I'm going to add text. That's this one. And you need to see what I'm doing, so let me just make space. So in here I'm going to have black text at 16-point aerial. I don't want that. I actually want, for this one, because of that color, I probably want maybe the yellow would look good, and I would guess maybe 28. I'll change it later if we need to. Get your copy now. Oh, let me select the text, change the color. Yeah, try the yellow. And 28, I said, which may be a little bit bigger. Let's just try 36. Yeah, okay, 36 looks good to me. Drag this over to the right. Maybe move it up a little bit. And you know what? I don't like that font, so I'm going to change it to the one I prefer. I like Arial and Rounded Bold, but you know, you can use any of these. You choose the one you like. I mean, in fairness, it's, you know, individual kind of thing, really. Personally, I quite like that one for this kind of text. You know, it just seems to stand out quite nicely. So now what we've got is this. You get a 100% ironclad, no questions, money back guarantee. All you have to do is get your copy now, click the button below, it'll be delivered to you in the next 30 seconds, something like that. Now I can see we've got a question, so let me just pause for that. Hi Susie, yes, it's being recorded. Yes, we've covered a lot, so yeah, it's been recorded. Now, you might have noticed I made a mistake there. Let me just stop this. What I didn't do was match that call out, the text, to the length of this clip. So I just drag it. You see how easy it is? Just drag it out. But the text actually fades before the button disappears. So you may or may not want that. I don't know. It depends on your personal preferences. I wouldn't have the text fading personally. I'd have the text and the video disappear at the same time. You know, but that's a personal preference. So now we've got this all the way here. Let me just shrink to fit. There we go. What I don't have is a lower third to brand this. It's great. It talks about a camping trip and, you know, a new book by Jason Smith and all that good stuff. It doesn't brand it. So what I'm going to do is go right back to the beginning and show you how to create a lower third to brand this particular video. I just need a little bit of space for this. I'm going to create a new track to do it on. Let me get some space to work with. There we go. And I'm going to use a call out. I've positioned my scrubber cursor at the very beginning of the video. I click on add call out. I'm going to choose this thing here, the rectangle, because I like that one personally. I'm going to have no border. I'm going to choose a fill for the color that I like, and I quite like that one personally, but you choose the one you like, you know what I mean? In fact, just for argument's sake, let me go with a different color today. Okay? I don't want shadow, I don't want any of these different styles, I don't want to flip it, I'm happy with those settings now. And what I'm going to do is position this where I want it to appear. And a lower third normally is going to be something like that. Not fully down at the bottom. You don't want it down here. You want it sort of here. And not necessarily the full length of the screen. And then the text, you put whatever you want. In my case, I'm going to put a website. So let's put camping, I forget what it was, camping.com.com. Get your copy for just $7 or whatever it might be. And I'm going to change the wording so that that one's slightly smaller and a different font and a different, you know, color. Okay. And actually, now I look at it, I don't like the domain name in black. So I'm going to change it to something a bit more vibrant, maybe yellow. Yeah, okay. I like that. So what I've got, if I scroll up to the top, where's it? Oh, it's put it here. I forgot to select track 8 by clicking in it, so it's put it down here. That was the one I was working on. So all I need to do is drag this straight up onto track 8. And now, a couple of things. Take out the fade out and the fade in. You'll see why in a second. They're both zero. Drag this to the full length of the video, which was there. Okay. And I'm going to go to more transitions. I'm going to look for the gradient wipe. Click it, drag it onto the beginning. Click it, drag it onto the end. And what we get now, if you watch here, let me resize it so you can see, you'll see the lower third come in and give my website, and you'll see how it appears. So the speed may need to be adjusted, but let's have a look. Actually, I quite like the speed, but I don't like that's too far. So here's what we do. Click on the rectangle we just created and drag it to the size you want, something like that. And actually, that could probably go a little bit further in, like that. Let's play it again and see if that looks better. Yeah, I like that. I'm happy with the position. I'm happy with the size of it. I might be tempted, personally, to make it just a little bit slower. So to do that, I'm going to zoom in here with this control so I can see what I'm doing. And then my gradient wipe, if I hover over the end here, we get the double-headed arrow. Drag it out a bit. So it's going to take three seconds. You can see there, just underneath the double headed arrow, it's showing me 3 seconds. So the gradient wipe is going to take 3 seconds to come in. If it's too slow, we'll change it, but let's have a look now. So this is what it looks like now. Let's just see. So this is a 3 second gradient wipe for the lower third. Ooh, I like that. Yeah, that's quite nice. 3 seconds is quite nice. So now I have that completely branded. What I would do, this is something to be aware of. I'm just going to zoom out so I can see the full timeline. There's the full timeline. I want to see if this actually gets in the way of any important information part way through. Because if I'm showing something down here, I'm obscuring it with my branding. So let me just scroll through. So far so good, so far so good. I'd be okay with that because the money back guarantee, yeah, I'm okay with that. Yeah, it's not obscuring anything. And now that I've seen this, I'm going to click on here, go to callouts so I can edit it, scroll down, choose an effect. I actually want the shadow. I think it does need the shadow to make it just lift it a little bit. You see there's a shadow now? So if we go back to the beginning, if I zoom in so you can see, I think the shadow probably just makes it that little bit nicer. Let's have a look. Yeah, personally, I think with this one, I like the shadow. And you can put anything you want in here. Now let me just see. I think I've got a couple of questions. Let's have a look. Okay. All right, just somebody asking if it was a recording. Yes, there's a recording here. So we've gone right back to the beginning, we've gone back to the lower thirds. We've talked about making yourself an authority with lower thirds by introducing yourself and your topic of expertise, or having somebody else introduce you. Just having a lower third with your name and your website. So let me show you something else. Here we go. That if I start changing this, let's just get rid of this message here. What I'm going to do is make that font slightly smaller, as you will see, and then okay. What you can do, if you have multiple websites or multiple services, you can actually demonstrate just how much involved you are in this kind of niche by putting them on there. You know, if you have five websites in the weight loss arena, one of them is a membership site, one of them is a diet site, one of them is a recipe site, one of them is an exercise site, you can emphasize all of them. And it establishes credibility. And all you've done there is type out some domain names. But you put them on this, in fact let me go to the beginning and just see what it looks like. You've put them on this lower third, and look, that's quite impressive. You know, now we can take that one stage further. Let's just do this. So I'm happy with that lower third. So what I'm going to do is copy it. Right, I've just selected it, and then I'm going to copy it, and I'm going to move it over here and come back to the beginning and paste it again. Okay, now because it's bigger than it could fit, it's actually gone to a new track, so let me just make this smaller and drag it down. And now what I'm going to do is change the wording. Just watch. Presented by Eamon Motin. Okay, and now we can see that we've got that. Yeah, let's just make that a bit smaller. I'm going to do the same trick again, paste it in here, and edit that again, and then put my weight loss websites are, okay. And now if I drag all these together, just watch what happens. It's probably a bit too slow, is that? So let me just make it shorter so you can get the effect. What you can do is kind of emphasize who you are, what you do, and tell people. Just tell them, look. So, presented by Eamon Motin. Oh, I've left it far too long. It's a 7 or 8 second. But I'll just let it play and then you can see what happens. So on the next transition, which should have been sooner, presented by Eamon Motin. Come on, we'll get there. That fades. My weight loss websites are, and then we list them. And in fact, let me just jump to that there. My weight loss websites are, and then you've got all these sites. Okay. And then if you want to, you repeat presented by Eamon Motin again, or you repeat your website branding, or whatever it is you want to emphasize for your particular branding. So you can use multiple lower thirds and have them give different information to establish credibility and expertise and so on. Just one final trick I want to show you, I promise, and then we will finish, because I know it's been a long time for everybody, is multiple lower thirds at the same time. Let me just show you. I've got to make some space for this, okay? So, I'm going to go here, and then I've got presented by, so let's have a look. I'm going to put this onto one line like that. I'm going to make the font a little bit smaller so we've got space, and I'm going to move this up like that so it doesn't take up quite as much space. Actually just want it one over like that, and then this one I'm going to drag above and watch what happens. So it's highlighting, or it's hiding the other one. So now if I highlight this rectangle, I can edit the text here. So let me just take out all the extraneous text that I didn't want. Change the font maybe to 20. Resize this. And I'm going to just change that font color to, I just want a slight difference there. So what should we say? Yeah, let's go for white. So now I've got two lower thirds. And if we watch them appear together, they appear together. That's cool. But I don't want them to appear together. I want my name first and then the camping.com. So all I do, this is camping.com, right? We'll zoom in so you can see what I'm doing. Move this so that it begins after the gradient has completed for my name. So just click on simple rectangle 5. That's the one for camping.com. Drag it over like that. And now when we watch that video again, let's see what happens. So first will be my name, and then will be camping.com. Okay, and you know, you can tweak these around if you want. That one, I think that's far too big, so I'd make this a bit smaller, like this, shall we say? Yep, something like that. And then it looks slightly different, so this is how it would appear. There we go. And then we've got the camping.com. So that's actually introducing information in stages, and you can then have one fade out if you want to, and so on. So in other words, what I'm saying to you is all these individual little techniques can be combined into a kind of super combo where you've got a fade and a gradient and an in and an out, and you know, multiple lower thirds and so on, to emphasize what you want to emphasize. Once you know how to do one of these, doing two of them is just the same. A third is the same, and you can combine them in any way you can think of. When you know how to do an animation, if you wanted to show this area here because there was something that people needed to read, you position yourself at the point where you need this to move. You go to More, Visual Properties, Add Animation, drag this where you want it so that you still get your branding. Okay. So let me show you that. So let's pretend, I'll zoom in for you. Let's pretend I've got something at the bottom that you need to be able to see. Camping.com is obscuring it. Let me move it for you at the point where you need to show the information that's been hidden. So now I could show that information at the bottom. And then when we're done, I can add another animation. Okay, let's say here, click on Add Animation. I've highlighted simple rectangle, so I'm working on this one, remember. Click animation and bring it back down to wherever you wanted. Okay, so it would then resize itself or reposition itself. And you see that happen in a second or two. So it would go back to the normal lower third position. There we go. So that's quite a lot that we've covered, and I understand that some of it, you know, it may be very new to you, and you've got to think about how to put things together. But essentially, by putting in something that looks like it's come out of a news studio, you can give yourself authority in any niche. You can put your name and say presented by, which automatically makes you a presenter. If you have somebody else introduce you, you can get a friend to introduce you. That gives you credibility. You can emphasize who you are with an image. I mean, if you've got a live action video, that's fine. If you don't, because you're shy, what you can do, you remember, let me just import a media. If you've got an image of yourself, let's say that author, there we go, you can drag that image on, and then, you know, put the image wherever you want it to be. That's far too big. You'd probably want to, you know, move it up into the top right hand corner. If you're interviewing somebody, you can have your image show when you're speaking, and then let me just show you. And then the other person's image show when they're speaking. So you can actually kind of have a visual indicator of, you know, you see? A visual indicator of who's speaking. And you'll have seen that on news programs sometimes when they're doing a satellite transmission that doesn't work. They sometimes have an image. If the reporter's having to call in from a phone, they'll sometimes just have an image up in the right hand corner, and when that person's speaking, it kind of zooms in, so you can actually do that. And if you're doing an interview, it could be a friend interviewing you, right? You can kind of keep the visual interest, even if you're not doing live action video. Now, I can see I've got a couple of questions. Let me just take those now. Chris, I don't know because I don't have access to those particular figures. I was just asked about how many of those ebooks have been sold for the camping. I don't know because I haven't got the figures. Okay, so what I'd like to do right now, if I just move this out of the way, is invite your questions. And remember, there's a webinar chat. If you haven't used it yet, you can send me a question or you can send it by email. Just for another minute or two, then we're going to close. Does anybody have any questions? Is there any technique you want me to show you again very quickly? Because I know we've covered quite a lot in quite a lot of depth. There will be a replay. One interesting thing that you'll find on the replay is that I'm going to brand it with the techniques that I've talked about. So you'll see me actually doing that in the replay video. And because I've got to edit the replay video, that means it will take a little bit of time. So it's probably going to be the weekend before that's available. But we'll let you know. I think I've got a couple of people asking here. Yes, Susie, it's being recorded. Anybody else got questions? Let me just see the popping up here. Okay. Cool. So let's have a look at this one. Can I make the teardrop slide in with the lower third? Yes, I can. I'll show you that in a second. Yes, Liz, there is a replay. Now, the teardrop, let me just show you that teardrop. So we go back to Camtasia. So let's go to the very beginning. I'll just get rid of these images there. So we've got this lower third. And what I can do is add a call out of this teardrop. So I'll click Add Call Out, choose teardrop. I'll stay with that color for now, okay? And I'm going to want to put it somewhere down here. And just make it, oops, let me zoom in so I've got space. I will make it, the full size of that call out. And what will happen now, you'll see that it appears. There we go. So that's just appeared. What we want it to do is to blend. So I'm going to show you blending in a second, but I want to position it the way I want it and so on. So let's just get a bit of working space. Number one, I actually want it to be beneath, so it's not hiding this lower third. So what I do is just move this lower third above it, and now I've got that lower third over the teardrop. But this lower third is still covered, so I've got to drag this lower third up as well. Or actually I could drag the teardrop down, whichever way you like, it doesn't really matter. Now, if I want this to appear with the same kind of what we call the gradient fill, let me just go to transitions. Gradient wipe. I just dragged gradient wipe onto the teardrop, and that means they will appear the same way. So let me show you. So the teardrop will appear at the same time as camping.com.com. But if I get rid of my name, you see it's not positioned right. So what I need to do is find the teardrop, which is this one, wedge 7. Let's move it down a little bit, because I don't like the look of it there. I would probably want it there, personally. Yeah, something like that. And maybe make the lower third just a little bit bigger. Okay. And now I have the two of them appearing together. So let me just show you. So here we go. And they appear together. But I can actually see now, when I looked at it, that the teardrop was taking a different time. So if we zoom in, you see what's happened? I've actually got them, first of all, they're not starting at exactly the same time, so I just need to drag them so they line up. And the gradients aren't the same speed, so I just need to match them. And I'm going to match it to this gradient, because that looks better. So now, if I play that again, we should get, yeah, that looks pretty good. So that's the teardrop appearing at the same time as the rectangle. Excuse me. Now let me show you that trick again. If you're happy with that, click this one, control click that one, and then group them so that now that's a single lower third. Yeah. That that works. Although actually I can see I've forgotten to move it there. At that point where I was moving this, I might need to move the teardrop as well. But all I would do is ungroup it, select the wedge, do visual properties, add animation, like we've done before. Okay, let me just think, see if I've got a couple of questions. Okay, I think we've covered all the questions. I'm just going to double quick check quickly. So if you haven't had your question answered, send it through again, please, and I'll see it. But I think all the questions that we were going to have, we've had. So thanks for joining me. One thing I would ask you to do, please do me a favour. If you would actually use the share buttons on the page that the webinar's on, it helps people to find out about them, and then they can join us next time. We've got a latecomer with a question. Yeah, there will be a replay. It's probably going to be Friday afternoon or Saturday, because I've got to do some editing. I'm actually going to put lower thirds on the edit, so you'll see the actual techniques being used on the replay. Okay. Thank you, Clifford. Thanks for joining me today. If there's any questions, just before we finish, anything you need to see again quickly, let me know, because we're going to finish in about 30 seconds if we don't have anything. Liz, there will be a full replay. Absolutely, and there's 2 solid hours, well, 2 hours and 20 minutes actually, so there's a lot to do. I may split it into 3 videos to make it more manageable for people, because it's a lot of stuff to look at. And you're asking about Camtasia. Well, we've been using Camtasia throughout, so I've shown you how to use it. And there is a link on the webinar page for getting the trial of Camtasia. So if you don't have it, you can get a trial of the latest one. Thanks, Chris. Thanks very much for that comment. By the way, if anybody's enjoyed it tonight, please do leave a testimonial. You can do that on the website. You know, there is a link to the testimonials page. It's lovely to get testimonials from people, and I appreciate it. Oh, Chris, cupcake. Don't tease me about food. That's terrible. Oh, man, that's just because we had that picture of the cupcakes earlier, and I haven't got any. I've got all the shops are closed, so I'm going to have to do that. Liz is asking about Movie Maker for Windows, which is a free application. It doesn't do this quite, no, not. As far as I'm aware, you can't do this kind of animation, no. No, but if you can't afford Camtasia at this stage, get the trial. Well, don't get the trial yet. What you should do is script out the videos you want to make, then get the trial of Camtasia and make all the videos you want to make in one batch over the next week or two. Because you can get a free trial, you see. And then you might have enough videos to last you a couple of months, and then try to get some revenue from your site so you can afford that. If you have iMovie on the Mac, you can use that. If you have Adobe Elements, you can do that as well. You know, there's lots of different ones that you can do. Camtasia is quite expensive, to be fair, but there is a free trial. So if you plan ahead, you can do dozens of videos. If you really worked at it, you could probably do enough to last you a full year. And use all these fantastic, you know, fancy animations and so on. So you don't have to do it. Cam Studio, personally, I wouldn't use. Very old. It's a bit flaky these days, you know. It's not my favourite. Thanks, Anita. You're very welcome. Okay, so I will see you next time. I'll let you know. We're probably not going to do webinars every week, because I know people are busy, and also for the longer webinars they do take a little bit to prepare, so I'll let everybody know when the replay is available. I'll email you, and I will also let you know when the next webinar is on. So thank you very much for joining me, and I'll see you next time. Bye now.